Namaskaram. In this session, we will discuss Cauchy-Riemann equations. They provide a criteria for the analyticity of a complex function. That is, using Cauchy-Riemann equations, we can easily check whether a given function is analytic or not. This is the statement of Cauchy-Riemann equations. We simply say that CR equations. Let uxy and vxy be real valued functions. Then the Cauchy-Riemann equations are these two pairs of partial differential equations. One is partial du by dx is equal to partial du by dy, and other one is partial du by dy is equal to minus partial dv by dx. For example, u equal to x square minus y square and v equal to 2xy. What is ux? So here ux stands for partial derivative of u with respect to x, that is 2x. And what is uy? Uy is minus 2y. And what about vx? Derivative with respect to x, so this is 2y. And what is vy? That is 2x. This implies what? Here ux equal to vy, right? These two are same. Ux equal to vy. So first differential equation is satisfied. The second one is uy. Here uy is minus 2y, vx is 2y, so uy is minus vx, right? Minus vx. So satisfies second equation. So these two functions together satisfies CR equations. Okay. Necessary condition for differentiability. If f of z equal to uxy plus ivxy is differentiable at a point z, then u and v satisfies CR equations at that point. A necessary condition means, consider a statement p implies q. This means what? If p is true, then q also true. In this case, q is a necessary condition for the statement p. Let's start the proof. Given that f dash of z exists at z, then we know that derivative is equal to limit delta z tends to 0 f of z plus delta z minus f of z by delta z. Okay, this limit exists and we denote this by f dash of z. We denote this equation by 1. We write delta z as delta x plus I delta y, that is real and imaginary parts of delta z. Then this implies z plus delta z become, we know that z is equal to x plus iy, delta z is denoted like this, so their sum is like this. This is the real part of this quantity and this is the imaginary part of this quantity. We also denote f of z as real and imaginary, that is uxy plus iv of xy. Then f of z plus delta z, this term become f of z plus delta z is this one, so we substituting here. So this becomes x plus delta x plus I into y plus delta y. And we know that f of x plus I y is equal to like this. U of x plus delta x, y become y plus delta y, like this. Okay. Now we have f of z plus delta z, f of z and delta z. Substituting everything in equation number 1. Then we get f dash of z is equal to limit delta z tends to 0 like this. Here these two terms are real and these two terms are imaginary. So comparing real and imaginary, we get like this. Then we split this limit, then we get like this. We know that the limit exists for all paths, so whatever be the path, limit is always same. So next we are going to consider two different paths. Okay, the first path is, we assume that delta z tends to 0 through real axis. So in this case, delta y equal to 0. That means, suppose this is our z. If delta z tends to 0 through real axis, then z plus delta z tends to z, a straight line parallel to x axis, right? So our f dash of z become like this. We simply substitute delta y equal to 0. Then we get like this. And what about this quantity? Here, this is the rate of change of u with respect to x alone. That is nothing, our partial derivative of u with respect to x. And similarly, what about this one? This is the rate of change of v with respect to x. That is our partial derivative of v with respect to x. So this quantity become partial du by dx and this is partial dv by dx. We denote this equation by equation number 2. Okay. Next, we assume that delta z tends to 0 through imaginary axis. That is delta x equal to 0. That means this is our 0. We assume that delta z tends to 0 through imaginary axis, either this direction or this direction. Whatever be delta z, then suppose this is our z, then what about z plus delta z? Then z plus delta z tends to z through a straight line parallel to y axis. So anyway, we assume that delta z tends to 0 through imaginary axis. So our f dash of z become like this. Then what about this first term? The first term is the derivative of u with respect to y, and second term is derivative of v with respect to y. So this expression become minus I. Okay, why minus I? We know that 1 by I is equal to minus I. This become minus I into partial du by dy, plus we can cancel these two I's. So the remaining term is partial dv by dy. Okay, we denote this equation by 3. So by equating 2 and 3, we get f dash of z is equal to like this. This is from equation number 2. This is from equation number 3. Then by comparing real and imaginary, we get like this, hence the proof. So f is differentiable at z, then the real and imaginary parts of f, u and v satisfies CR equations. As a remark, now we have seen that if f of z is differentiable at z, then u and v satisfies CR equations. Moreover, we can find f dash of z in terms of partial derivatives of u and v in four different ways. The one advantage of CR equation is we can find f dash of z if u or v alone is known using these two formulas. Next one, necessary condition for analyticity. If f of z is analytic at a point z, then u and v satisfy CR equations in a neighborhood of z. We know that a function is analytic at a point z when it is differentiable in a neighborhood of z. Neighborhood of z means an open circular disk. So analytic means it is differentiable in a neighborhood. So by previous result, it satisfies CR equations in a neighborhood. Okay. Next one, sufficient condition for differentiability. If uxy and vxy satisfies Cauchy-Riemann equations and has continuous first order partial derivatives at z, then f of z is differentiable at z. The proof of this sufficient condition is beyond the scope of our syllabus. This is our result. Okay, so we have two conditions. One is u and v satisfy CR equations at z, and all the four first order partial derivatives are continuous at z, then this result says that f of z equal to u plus iv is differentiable at z. So what is the sufficient condition for analyticity? For analyticity, function should be differentiable in a neighborhood. Okay, so this condition should satisfy in a neighborhood, that's all. So this is the sufficient condition for analyticity. U and v satisfy CR equations and has first order partial derivatives in a neighborhood of z, then f is equal to u plus iv is analytic at z. Okay, that means f is differentiable in a neighborhood of z, that's all.
Find the points at which the following functions are differentiable, analytic. If it is differentiable, then find the derivative at that points. Okay, the first problem is f of z equal to z square. Already we have seen that z square is differentiable everywhere using the limiting definition of differentiation. Now we are going to solve this problem using Cauchy-Riemann equations. Okay, so this can be written as, this is equal to, and I square is minus 1, so this become, so the real part u equal to and imaginary part v equal to. Next we have to check whether the u and v satisfies Cauchy-Riemann equations. These are the partial derivatives of u. Already we have seen that u and v satisfies Cauchy-Riemann equations. So u and v satisfies Cauchy-Riemann equations all the values of z. Next we have to check whether the first order partial derivatives are continuous or not. Here all the first order partial derivatives are polynomials, and we know that all the polynomials are continuous. Here u and v satisfies two sufficient conditions for differentiability. So our function z square is differentiable for all z. Then how to find the derivative? We know that f dash of z is equal to ux plus ivx. This is equal to, what is our ux? That is 2x. psi into what is Vx is 2y. So this become 2 into x plus iy. So this is equal to 2z. So f dash of z is equal to 2z. So next problem, f z equal to z bar. And first we have to find the real and imaginary parts. So this is equal to x minus iy. So what is u? So u is x and v is equal to minus y. Next we have to find the partial derivatives. So here ux is 1, uy is 0, and vx is 0, and vy is minus 1. Our Cauchy-Riemann equations are, so here uy is 0 and vx is 0. So z bar satisfies this Cauchy-Riemann equation. But what about ux and vy? Here ux is 1 and vy is minus 1. So they are never equal. This function does not satisfy this Cauchy-Riemann equation. So in general, our z bar doesn't satisfy Cauchy-Riemann equation at any point. So Cauchy-Riemann equation is one of the minimum, it's a necessary condition. That means a minimum condition for differentiability. That means z bar is nowhere differentiable. Next problem, f of z equal to mod z square. And this is equal to mod z is square root of x square plus y square. So mod z square is x square plus y square. So there is no imaginary part. So it's u equal to, and imaginary part is 0. Right. So these are the first order partial derivatives. Next we have to check whether u and v satisfies Cauchy-Riemann equations or not. The Cauchy-Riemann equations are, u and v satisfies Cauchy-Riemann equations if and only if our ux is 2x, so 2x is equal to 0 because vy is 0, and uy equal to minus vx, that is 2y equal to 0 and 2y equal to 0, and 2x equal to 0 and 2y equal to 0, that is if and only if x equal to 0 and y equal to 0. So that means this function u and v satisfies Cauchy-Riemann equations only at 0, 0, that is origin. Okay, so u and v satisfies CR equations only at z equal to 0, that is our origin. Okay, next we have to check whether first order partial derivatives are continuous at 0 or not. Here the first order partial derivatives are polynomials and constants. So it is clear that they are continuous everywhere. So in particular, ux, uy, vx, vy are continuous at z equal to 0. So as per sufficient condition of differentiability, so mod z square is differentiable only at z equal to 0. Then what is the derivative of mod z square at 0? That is, and what is ux at 0? Ux at 0 is 0. When you substitute 0, this becomes 0. What is vx? Vx is always 0. 0. So this is 0 to 0. So this function f of x is differentiable only at z equal to 0, and derivative at 0 is 0. Okay. So this function differentiable only at z equal to 0. So it is nowhere analytic because it is differentiable only at z equal to 0 and not differentiable at all other points. So this function is nowhere analytic, but it is differentiable at z equal to 0. Right. This is equal to e raised to x plus iy, that is e raised to x into e raised to iy. By Euler's formula, this can be written as e raised to x into cos y plus I sin y. This is equal to, so the real part of e raised to z, u equal to e raised to x into cos y. Imaginary part, v equal to e raised to x into sin y. So ux equal to e raised to x cos y, uy equal to minus e raised to x sin y, vx equal to e raised to x sin y, vy equal to e raised to x cos y. So it is clear that ux equal to vy and uy equal to minus vx. So u and v satisfies Cauchy-Riemann equations. Okay. And also here the partial derivatives are functions of e raised to x and cos y and e raised to x and sin y. all these functions are continuous. So our first order partial derivatives are continuous. So e raised to z is differentiable everywhere. Okay, and how to find f dash of z? We can find f dash of z using this formula. There are four formulas. You can use any formula. In this case, I'm going to use this formula, ux minus ivy. And what is ux? So f dash of z is equal to, what is ux? Ux is e raised to x into cos y minus I into, what is ui? It is minus e raised to x into sin y. So this become e raised to x is common, cos y plus I sin y. So this is equal to, and this is cos theta plus I sin theta form. So this is e raised to I y, and this is equal to e raised to x plus I y. This is equal to e raised to z. So yes, f dash of z equal to e raised to z. And now this function is differentiable everywhere. So it is analytic everywhere. A function f of z equal to u plus iv is constant if and only if u and v are constants. This is a very trivial statement. Here we consider u as a function of xy, and derivative with respect to x and y both are zero. That means u is independent of x and u is independent of y. That means u must be a constant. That's all. Okay, here f of z is analytic means it is analytic in some domain D. Okay. This domain D may be entire complex plane. If f of z equal to u plus iv is analytic and real part of f of z is constant, then we have to show that f of z is throughout constant. What is real part of f of z? That is u. So given that u is a constant, let it be k. So what about ux and uy? Both are zero, right? U is equal to a constant k. So derivative with respect to x and y both are zero. And we know that f of z is analytic. So u and v satisfies Cauchy-Riemann equations. That means ux equal to vy and uy equal to minus vx. So this implies 0 equal to vy, right? So vy equal to 0. And our uy equal to 0. So this implies vx equal to 0. So vx and vy both are 0. This implies v is a constant. Given that u is a constant, now we get v is also a constant. So what happened? U plus iv is also a constant. That means our f is constant. Okay, next problem. If f of z equal to u plus iv is analytic and modulus of f of z is constant, then we have to show that f of z is constant. That means we have to show that u and v are constants. Okay, so given that modulus of f of z is constant, that means square root of u square plus v square equal to constant. By taking squares on both sides, we get u square plus v square is also a constant, because a constant square is also a constant. Let it be k. This is our equation number 1. First we differentiate 1 with respect to x. Then we get, and this implies a 2 is common, you can take outside and cancel. This is our equation number 2. Next we differentiate 1 with respect to y. And this implies, this is our equation number 3. Given that f of z is analytic, so u and v satisfies Cauchy-Riemann equations. Okay. That is, using these Cauchy-Riemann equations, we are going to convert equation number 2 and 3 in terms of the partial derivatives vx and vy alone. Okay. That means we are going to replace ux by vy and uy by minus vx in 2 and 3. Okay, so in place, this is our equation number 4, and 3 in place, this is our equation number 5. Now we are going to treat Vx and Vy are two unknowns, and we have two equations, so we can solve Vx and Vy from these two equations. Okay, so we consider u into 4, equation number 4. This is our equation number 6. Next one, v into equation number 5. That is minus uv into vx plus v square into vy equal to 0. This is our equation number 7. Next we consider 6 plus 7. Okay, here these two terms are same but opposite sign. So if you take the 6 plus 7, these two become cancelled out. The remaining term is vy is common, you can take outside. So this becomes u square plus v square into vy equal to 0. And this implies, whereas by our assumption, u square plus v square is a constant, k. So this becomes k into vy equal to 0. And this implies vy equal to 0. If k equal to 0, there's one possibility, k equal to 0. If k equal to 0, then what happened? These two are some square terms, u square plus v square. If u square plus v square equal to 0, then u square and v square both are 0. That means u and v are 0. U and v are 0 means f is equal to 0. Anyway, f is a constant. We have to show that f is a constant, right? So now we assume that k is a non-zero number. Here we assume that k is a non-zero number. Because if k equal to 0, then f is automatically 0, right? So if k not equal to 0, then this vy should 0. Substituting this vy equal to 0 in equation number 4, then we get v into vx equal to 0. This implies vx equal to 0. Because if v equal to 0, then automatically vx is 0, right? Derivative of 0 is 0. If v is non-zero, then vx should be 0. Because this product should be 0, right? So whatever be the case, vx is always 0. Two equations, one is vx equal to 0, other is vy equal to 0. So combining these two, this implies v is a constant. Then substituting this vx equal to 0 and vy equal to 0 in Cauchy-Riemann equations, we get ux and uy both are 0. Ux equal to 0 and uy equal to 0 means u is a constant. Now u and v are constant. So what happened? Our f is u plus iv. And now u and v are constant, so f is a constant. This is your homework. Thank you.